Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Roman Revolution, Crisis and Christianity in Ancient Rome, by Nick Holmes. Narrated by Nigel Patterson. A revolution is impossible without a revolutionary situation. Vladimir Lenin, 1913. Introduction. The road to Rome lay open. Clouds of dust hung in the air like mist. An army was on the march. Noise reverberated. The tramp of feet, the rattle of iron, the neighing of horses. Long columns of heavily armoured legionaries and horsemen were marching south along the Via Flaminia towards the Eternal City. The Roman Emperor Constantine was riding with his army to fight his rival Maxentius. It was AD 312, and the Battle of the Milvian Bridge was about to be fought. This has been seen as a turning point not just in the history of the Roman Empire, but of the entire world, for, according to a Christian chronicler of the time, it was on this same road that a vision converted Constantine to Christianity. Thereafter, Christianity, which had not long before been a persecuted religion, became the official religion of the Roman Empire. The story goes like this. The day was hot, the sun was blinding, but as Constantine looked at it, he saw that it was no ordinary sun. In front of it, there appeared a cross of light, and words written in Greek seemed to say, En tuto nika, in this conquer. That night, he had a dream. Jesus Christ promised him victory if his soldiers marked their shields with a Christian symbol. The next day, Constantine hastily instructed his soldiers to paint two letters in Greek, Chi and Rho, on their shields. They were the first two letters of Christ's name, Christos. Later that day, on the 28th of October, AD 312, the two armies joined battle. The sources provide few details, but it seems that Constantine's horsemen won a first engagement over Maxentius's cavalry. Then Constantine's infantry pushed Maxentius's soldiers back towards the Milvian Bridge that crossed the River Tiber. At some point there was panic among Maxentius's men as they became trapped against the river. They fled not to the Milvian Bridge itself, which had been partially destroyed to stop Constantine's army from crossing it, but to a fragile pontoon bridge set up beside it. This swayed under the weight of the fleeing soldiers, and then collapsed. The result was carnage. Maxentius's soldiers were cut down or drowned in the Tiber. Only the Praetorian Guard stayed loyal to him and fought to the death. Maxentius himself drowned in the Tiber. His body was later retrieved, and Constantine paraded his severed head through the streets of Rome. According to the Christian chroniclers, it was from that time onwards that Constantine set about converting the Roman Empire to Christianity. But what really happened? Most modern historians now believe that the story of Constantine's conversion was just that, a story. Yet what is not in doubt is that by the time of the battle, Christianity had become the fastest growing religion in the empire. Its growth had been slow to begin with. In AD 100, there were perhaps as few as 10,000 Christians. By AD 250, there were around 1 million. Then growth surged. By AD 300, over 10% of the entire population of the Roman Empire was Christian. By AD 350, this had risen to over 50%, with 30 to 40 million Christians. So what caused this? This book tries to answer that question. But it is not a theological book about Christianity. It is about a revolution in the ancient world. This began as a crisis. Long before the fall of the Roman Empire in the 5th century, a terrible ordeal gripped Rome for 50 years, between AD 235 and 285. From the west came wave after wave of barbarian invaders. From the east came the mailed horsemen of Sasanian Persia. And from within, civil war, mutinous armies, plague, and economic decline sapped the empire's strength. It was the fall before the fall. Yet Rome survived. The emperors Aurelian, Diocletian, and Constantine breathed life into a revolutionary new Rome. Politically, economically, and culturally, it was very different from the ancient Rome that had received a mortal blow. The rise of Christianity was a product of these troubled times, but it was just one of many radical changes. It is also a time that has been largely forgotten. Historians have neglected it because of its obscurity. Very few records have survived. Due to this, it has become a lost age. Yet it was arguably the most important century in the entire history of Rome. Of the few historians who have written about it, some see it as the end of the ancient world, while others simply call it the crisis of the 3rd century. This book suggests a new name, the Roman Revolution. Part 1. Republic. 1. City-state. To understand the crisis that gripped Rome in the 3rd century, we need to know what it was before. So let us start at the beginning with a question that historians have long debated. Just how did a small city-state rise from total obscurity to become one of the greatest empires in history? Rome began as a small settlement perched upon a few hills surrounding the river Tiber, about 15 miles from the sea. Its true origins will never be known for sure. Roman writers, such as Pliny and Virgil, writing centuries afterwards, embellished entirely fictional legends born long before they wrote them down. These appealed to the ancient Romans as much as to us today. The most famous of all was that of the twin brothers Romulus and Remus, who founded the city, having been abandoned at birth and suckled by a she-wolf. Greek writers added to this by linking the twins to the legend of Aeneas, a Trojan refugee who fled to Italy and married Lavinia, the daughter of the king of Latium, where Rome would later be founded, thereby romantically suggesting that Romans had Trojan blood in their veins. But what really happened? Archaeological evidence points to a native Italian settlement on the hills of ancient Rome in about 1000 BC. Roman historians traditionally dated it to 753 BC, with Rome becoming the chief city of the Latium region by around 500 BC. Surrounded by other Italian tribes, principally the Etruscans to the north and the Samnites to the east, Rome gradually developed a political leadership position in central Italy, with Etruscan and Samnite towns owing it allegiance. How did the Romans achieve this? This is probably the most enigmatic question in the whole of Roman history, for there is simply no convincing surviving evidence from this period, either literary or archaeological, on which to base any verifiable hypothesis. The expected answer would be by force of arms. This was certainly the interpretation developed by later Roman writers such as Virgil and Livy. They were inclined to praise their early ancestors for possessing a military bravado that heroically overcame their rivals. But there is little evidence to support such a self-serving myth. Indeed, it is almost certain that the Roman militia was no better equipped or organized than those of its neighboring towns, and Rome certainly did not benefit from having a professional army to begin with, although this would in later centuries become a hallmark of Roman authority. Additionally, Romans at an individual level were presumably just as brave or cowardly as their neighbours. It is clearly nonsense to suggest that they inherited Trojan genes that made them into a special race, as Virgil liked to imagine. Instead, the only vaguely discernible evidence that suggests early Rome had a competitive advantage seems to lie first with its larger size compared to most of its neighbours, and then with its development of a clever and pragmatic form of diplomacy. Rome's relatively large size stemmed from its seven hills, which attracted many different tribes to live in close proximity. The Palatine Hill was the one associated by the later Romans with the legend of Romulus, while the other hills were occupied by separate and sometimes hostile tribes. The valleys between the hills were fairly marshy until they were drained. Indeed, the Roman Forum was originally marshland, until it was converted into a public area for the hill tribes to use as a meeting place and market, and later as a place of worship. When the tribes of the Seven Hills eventually united into a single political entity, what then propelled Rome's power and influence was the establishment of a network of allies, first in the form of the Latin League of Italian towns, and then more widely across central Italy, so that by 265 BC it had more than 150 towns owing it allegiance in a sort of commonwealth. One probable reason for this successful early expansion was Rome's light-touch government and leadership. Rome allowed its allies, and even conquered towns, considerable autonomy. It required only military service from them, and was surprisingly ready to reward them with Roman citizenship, or soft versions of it. This approach to government was in striking contrast to, say, the style of the government of the Greek city-states of the 5th century BC. For example, 5th century Athens was so fiercely protective of its citizen status that it would not grant it to anyone born outside Athens. In contrast, Rome was happy to grant diluted citizenship to the members of the Latin League, and an even more diluted version of citizenship to its Socii, as its more distant Italian allies were called. This allowed it gradually to integrate most of central Italy into a Roman-dominated political entity. Perhaps the real driver for this early success lay in necessity, and in particular the challenges created by its central geographic location. Necessity is the mother of invention, and surrounded by Etruscan and Samnite tribes, Rome was forced to make alliances with its neighbours just to survive. Turning these alliances into a Roman commonwealth of allied Socii was the next logical step. And Rome was able to do this because it was the biggest fish in its own relatively small pond. But one thing we can be sure of: the early Romans had no plan for world domination. They would have been more surprised than anyone to hear that, by extending their sphere of influence, they had taken the first step towards the creation of a future superpower. 2. Italian Champion. Despite its initial success, Rome's early path to glory was not always a smooth process. For example, in 496 BC, a diminishing threat from the powerful Etruscan towns in the north caused the Latin League to turn against Rome. The result was a bloody battle at Lake Regillus, which Rome only just won. However, one advantage the early Romans possessed was that their leadership was normally welcomed by their neighbours when external pressures became more acute. An important example of this occurred in around 400 BC, on the occasion of a major Gallic invasion of northern Italy. Tribes of primitive Gauls, ferociously aggressive in battle, crossed the Alps and devastated the Etruscan towns in the Po Valley. Rome itself was sacked in 387 BC, although its citadel held out, famously saved, according to Livy, by the Geese warning of a night attack. Fortunately, the Gauls retreated, probably in fact because they were paid off rather than defeated in battle. But the important point is that the incident seems to have strengthened, not weakened, Rome's leadership position, as it became a champion of Italian defence against further Gallic invasions. Another byproduct of the Gallic invasion was an acceleration in Rome's military prioritisation. Massive walls were constructed after the Gallic Wars, the so-called Servian Walls, to protect Rome. Some of these survive today outside the modern Termini station in central Rome, and their size is compelling evidence to suggest that Rome was, by the late 4th century BC, a fairly large town with a strong military ethos. The main benefit to Rome of its federation of allies was military, for it enabled it to mobilise militias across its whole network. This was not a trading confederation, such as that of 5th century Athens, but instead a system designed to achieve mass mobilization of peasant soldiers when required. This meant that Roman armies consisted of as many, if not more, allied soldiers than Roman ones, although they were normally commanded by Roman generals. This gave the Romans strength in numbers, which was to prove particularly important as Rome came into contact with powerful new enemies. This occurred around 280 BC, when Rome was the established leader of all the Etruscan, Samnite, and other Italian tribes in central Italy. At this time, it came into conflict with the Greek city-states in southern Italy. The Greeks had occupied Sicily and southern Italy for centuries, with Syracuse historically the most prominent of all the Greek-Italian city-states. However, they had all declined in power since the days when Syracuse had withstood the onslaught of Athens during the Peloponnesian War in the 5th century. By the 3rd century BC, much of Sicily was under Carthaginian control, and the Romans thought they had little to fear from the remaining cities scattered along the southern Italian coastline. But worryingly for Rome, these Greek city-states, while relatively weak themselves, could call for help from their powerful cousins on the Greek mainland. This was exactly what happened when the Italian Greek city of Tarentum appealed for help against Rome to King Pyrrhus of Epirus, one of the most powerful of the Greek mainland states at this time. Sensing an opportunity to conquer Italy, he brought a large and well-equipped army from mainland Greece to southern Italy. This posed a threat to Rome, which only just survived by mobilizing substantial militia from its Italian allies. Victorious in battle against the Romans, who nonetheless refused to concede defeat, and suffering from heavy casualties himself, from which the term Pyrrhic victory is derived. In 275 BC, Pyrrhus retired back to Greece, where he was compelled to fight his neighbouring Macedonians. Rome had survived its first international conflict, and soon all the Greek city-states in southern Italy saw that resistance was futile, and like the Latin towns had done before, offered Rome their allegiance. By 265 BC, Rome was the political and military leader of the Italian peninsula south of the Po Valley, which was still occupied by Gallic tribes, and came up against its first great power opponent, Carthage. Carthage was a city-state, originally founded as a colony of the powerful Phoenician city of Tyre in about 814 BC. By 265 BC, Carthage had effectively severed its ties with the eastern Mediterranean and had established itself as the leading commercial state in the western Mediterranean. Based in modern-day Tunisia, it controlled the North African coastline from Gibraltar to Libya, the southern and eastern Spanish coastline, Corsica, Sardinia, and most of Sicily. Carthage was one of the four superpowers of the ancient world at this time, the other three being the successor states to Alexander the Great's vast empire, namely the Antigonid Kingdom of Macedonia dominating northern Greece, the vast Seleucid Empire based in modern Turkey, Syria, Iraq, and Iran, and the Ptolemaic Empire based in Egypt and the Levant. As such, Carthage represented by far the most powerful enemy Rome had ever faced. During three separate wars, lasting some 80 years, from 264 to 146 BC, the Romans defeated and destroyed Carthage. However, Roman victory was immensely hard-fought, with Hannibal inflicting some of the worst defeats ever suffered by the Roman army, at the battles of Lake Trasimene and Cannae, 217 and 216 BC, when he invaded Italy during the Second Punic War. But Rome prevailed for two main reasons. First, its superiority in manpower, derived from its control of a much larger population in Italy than Carthage possessed in North Africa. This meant it could absorb far higher casualty rates than the Carthaginians. Second, Rome proved to be far better at constructing a fleet than Carthage expected, leading to unexpected victory in the First Punic War. Roman victory over Carthage was a game-changer. Not only did it expand Roman territory into Africa and Spain, but it gave Rome complete mastery over the western Mediterranean and a powerful navy matched only by that of Ptolemaic Egypt. Rome now came face to face with the remaining three great powers of the ancient world. However, in contrast to its hard-fought victory over Carthage, victory over these was almost handed to Rome on a plate. But before analysing the reasons for Roman victory in the eastern Mediterranean, we must consider another of Rome's defining features, and the extent to which it contributed to early Rome's path to glory. This was the peculiar nature of its political constitution, the Roman Republic. 3. Republic. Kings originally ruled Rome, although no evidence survived either for the later Romans themselves or for us to construct any sort of accurate insight into what those times were like. The Republican Romans had a legend that the last Roman king, Tarquin the Proud, was expelled in 509 BC after his son raped a Roman noblewoman, Lucretia, who subsequently committed suicide, prompting such outrage among Roman citizens that they rebelled against the monarchy and replaced it with a republic. Whatever the truth about this, it is certainly accurate that for nearly 500 years, from around 500 BC until 27 BC, the rulers of the Roman Republic were two consuls voted into office for 1 year only by the Roman citizens. By the time of the empire, the position of consul still existed, but was no more than a name. Indeed, the Emperor Caligula, AD 37 to 41, allegedly planned to make his horse Incitatus consul, with the stipulation that it could vote on matters of state by defecating on the floor of the Senate and using its hoof to move the horse dung in the direction of the senators whose proposals it agreed with. While the story of Caligula's horse was probably the comic invention of the Roman historian Suetonius, his bittersweet joke underlined the dramatic change in government that occurred as Rome transitioned from republic to empire, a subject to which we will turn later. The point to note, however, is that by the time of the empire, Romans, such as the gifted writer Tacitus, mourned the loss of the democratic republic and its replacement by an effective monarchy under the emperors. But was Tacitus over-sentimental about the republic being a true democracy? The answer is yes, for while the republic bore the trappings of democracy, it was in reality always a benign oligarchy run by the rich and powerful members of Roman society. This may seem surprising, since constitutionally, the Republic was what we might call a representative democracy, with government by groups of elected representatives, such as exists today in many modern-day democratic institutions, including the UK Parliament and the US House of Representatives. In Rome, this took the form of citizen assemblies, the most important of which was the Comitia Centuriata, Centuriate Assembly, whose members were divided into 193 centuries, or voting blocks. Each century had one vote, which was cast according to the wishes of the simple majority of its members. It voted on the appointment of the most important political figures, such as the consuls. Another assembly, called the Comitia Tributa, Tribal Assembly, voted on proposals made by the consuls and other elected representatives. However, in practice, the opportunity for free and fair elections was severely limited for the Roman electorate for two reasons. First, the Senate chose the candidates for office and not the citizens. This effectively prevented plebeian candidates from being put forward, except in exceptional circumstances, and meant the vast majority of candidates were chosen from among whichever aristocratic faction in the Senate was the most powerful. Second, voting occurred in the Forum in Rome, spilling over into the Campus Martius, to the north of the Forum, if need be. As the Republic expanded, and most of the inhabitants of Italy became Roman citizens, they could vote only by travelling to Rome and voting there in person. Rather surprisingly, no balloting system for citizens living outside Rome was ever devised, which meant that Roman citizens outside the capital, who could not travel to Rome to vote, and very few could, were effectively disenfranchised. To put these logistical problems into context, a Roman census conducted at the end of the 1st century BC counted 4 million Roman citizens scattered across the Mediterranean. A few years earlier, Cicero recorded that voting for one consul in 45 BC took 5 hours, which suggests to historians that in most Roman elections there was probably an average of only 10,000 to 20,000 voters. So in the later Republic, when there were perhaps 3 to 4 million voters, if only 20,000 of them normally voted, this would equate to 2% of the total electorate. This is extremely low compared with voter turnout in the modern Western democracies. For example, voter turnout in the 2020 US presidential election was 66.8%, a little higher than the average 50 to 60% for most presidential elections since the Second World War. This meant that in reality, the Roman Republic was a sham democracy. Political power really lay with the Senate. For although the consuls could theoretically be chosen from anyone who put themselves forward for election, it quickly became established that only senators could be nominated, since they had the necessary experience of government. This meant that the Senate was the centre of almost all political activity and became a hotbed of political intrigue, as the great aristocratic and wealthy Roman families fought it out for election to the office of consul. Nevertheless, the Roman Republic seemed to work remarkably well. Indeed, the Greek historian Polybius, writing in the 2nd century BC and musing on why Rome spiralled to success at the expense of the Greek states, attributed much of it to this republican political structure, which he deemed to contain an excellent system of checks and balances. Elaborating on this, he explained that the way in which Rome had a mix of kingship, aristocracy, and democracy provided reasonably firm but not dictatorial government with sufficient buy-in from the ordinary Roman citizens to make the whole system work. Most important of all, the Roman constitution avoided the pitfalls of each of the three types of government. As Polybius wrote, monarchy degenerates into tyranny, aristocracy into oligarchy, and democracy into savage violence and chaos. It has to be said that there is much truth in Polybius's assessment. For the striking feature of the Roman Republic up until the 1st century BC was that it avoided the excesses of being either a monarchy, an oligarchy, or mob rule, just as Polybius noted. This was partly because the constitutional requirement to change the two consuls each year was rigidly upheld, ensuring that there was a semblance of democratic government, even though, in effect, it was a form of aristocratic oligarchy. But this oligarchy never became too corrupt, because there was always healthy competition for power between the senators. This meant that the Republic avoided being a despotic oligarchy. There was just enough democracy to keep senators honest. As an example of this, Polybius noted that Roman consuls were particularly sensitive to public opinion and always eager to secure public approval. As for the people, the consuls are preeminently obliged to court their favour, however distant from home may be the field of their operations. For it is the people, as I have said before, that ratifies or refuses to ratify terms of peace and treaties. But most of all, because when laying down their office, they have to give an account of their administration before it. Therefore, in no case is it safe for the consuls to neglect either the Senate or the goodwill of the people. So the Republic achieved a truly remarkable political balancing act. In the ancient world, just as in the modern, this was highly unusual. In the modern world, we have only to look at the monarchical governments of Vladimir Putin in Russia and Xi Jinping in China to see that by comparison with them, the Roman Republic was refreshingly free from tyranny and corruption. Somehow, the Romans seem to have understood well the maxim that power tends to corrupt and absolute power corrupts absolutely. However, even the Republic could not remain impervious forever to human greed for power. For it would not be long before dictators seized control, purporting to act within the framework of the Republic, and then emperors would take control, again purporting to be the people's representatives. Ultimately, the Roman political system ended up as a military dictatorship sanctioned by a Christian god. But before continuing with the story of Rome's troubled passage from republic to empire, we need to consider another vitally important aspect of Roman life, and one which was crucial to the very ethos and existence of both the Roman Republic and the empire. This was the Roman army. 4. The legions. In the early centuries of the Roman Republic, 500 to 250 BC, there was nothing special about the Roman army. While today the word legion has become symbolic of military might, similar to words such as panzer division or Viking, originally there was nothing special about the Latin word for legion, legio, which simply meant a levy of militia. It was no different from the militia levies universal across all Italian and Greek city-states. So how did the Roman legions become some of history's most famous fighting machines? To start at the beginning, as the Roman levy grew in size, reflecting the city's growth, the legio was divided into two legiones, and by 311 BC there were probably four of them. The number of legions kept growing as Rome became larger. But for much of their early history, the legions were not particularly different from the Etruscan and Samnite militias they repeatedly faced in battle. Originally, what came to distinguish the legiones was neither their ferocity nor their quality, but quite simply their numbers. As described in a previous chapter, the Roman army's success against Pyrrhus and the Greek city-states in southern Italy was largely because of the availability of superior manpower. This was almost entirely because of Rome's impressive network of Italian allies, which allowed the mobilization of much larger armies than those of its Etruscan, Gallic, and ultimately Carthaginian adversaries. This enabled the Romans to frustrate Pyrrhus's army, which was worn down through his Pyrrhic victories. Roman mass mobilization was also what finally defeated Hannibal's superior military machine when he invaded Italy in the Second Punic War, 218 to 202 BC. But during the Punic Wars, and as Rome turned east to take on Alexander the Great's successor states, something else happened to the Roman army that distinguished it from its opponents. This was a marked rise in its professionalism. This meant that, in the 2nd century BC, the Roman legionary was able to do something truly revolutionary, to reinvent ancient battlefield tactics by making the Greek phalanx redundant. The Greek phalanx was the tank of the ancient world, and dominated warfare for most of the 3rd century BC. It comprised large numbers of pikemen wielding 16-foot pikes in a formation a bit like a hedgehog. Invented by King Philip II of Macedon in the 4th century, and used by his son, Alexander the Great, to devastating effect against the Achaemenid Persian armies, it became the standard military unit in all the Hellenistic armies of the successor states. However, the phalanx was deeply flawed if it was managed poorly on the battlefield. Although it was always difficult to stop a frontal assault by the phalanx, the pikemen were vulnerable to attack on their unprotected sides. In Alexander's day, he overcame this flaw by using cavalry and heavy infantry to protect the phalanx's flanks. Indeed, Alexander never regarded the phalanx as the key to unlocking victory. He merely used it as a way of blocking enemy attacks while his superb cavalry dealt knockout blows to his enemies in brilliantly executed manoeuvres. The problem that undermined the Greek successor states was that they simply did not have generals as skilled as Alexander, and consequently the phalanx's flaws became increasingly exposed, and it was the Romans who exploited this deficiency the best. In contrast to the Greeks, the Romans had never liked using the phalanx. It was not well suited either to the hilly Italian countryside or to the open order fighting of the Gauls. Instead, in the 4th century BC, the Romans started to use small combat units of infantry called maniples. These were normally 120 men strong and could be used flexibly in both defence and attack. In particular, they could swarm around the unprotected flanks of the phalanxes, massacring the pikemen who were locked into an unwieldy and tight formation. This is exactly what happened in 197 BC, when the Romans completely outmaneuvered the vast 16,000-man-strong Macedonian phalanx at the Battle of Cynoscephalae and slaughtered thousands of pikemen. The Seleucid phalanx suffered the same fate at the Battle of Magnesia in 190 BC. The 2nd century Greek historian Polybius wrote that the Roman maniples had changed the course of history. Another tactical innovation developed by the early Roman army was the use of a throwing javelin in place of a spear. This proved remarkably successful in close quarter combat, since the launch of these missiles unnerved opposing infantry and cavalry before combat was joined. Again, it was particularly deadly against Greek phalanx and hoplite formations. The Romans' increasing military prowess, in addition to their ability to field large armies, was a game-changer in the ancient world. But what was the reason for the emergence of this growing military know-how and confidence? Again, we must turn to our most reliable and insightful source for the early Roman army, the Greek historian Polybius. Writing in the 2nd century BC, Polybius described the Roman army's discipline as its greatest asset. As an example of this, he emphasized that the death.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.